Matt Petrovick here. I'm the grandpa of this family.
Talk to him.
And I'm 75 years old, going on 95. And we're sitting in my laboratory, where I spend most of my time experimenting. And so, Matt, I guess you have some questions for me. Fire away.
Okay, when did you first hear about or see Grandma?
Well, one night back about 1950, three or four of the guys and I were out. Be working for us, and we're still dancing. So we've been dancing all those years, and unfortunately the accumulation has taken its toll on my knees. Now I have two artificial knees. That's another story.
Yeah. Okay, I got a question. This one was thought up by my parents. Did you guys ever go parking?
Parking? What's that?
Where you drive out, you know, I don't know, go on dates, I guess. Dad, you want to go deeper on that?
Well, we didn't go out on dates just to go parking. But, you know, when you bring a girl home and you stop off in front of her house, you got to park, right?
Yeah.
So, you know, naturally there's a little kissing and hugging going on there, but you never know if her mother might not be looking through the window. Yeah. So you got to be very careful. So that kind of didn't represent any real problem. And then walk her to the door. And so there you are.
So what did you like most about Grandma?
Well, she, one thing I omitted is she was already in business for herself. She owned and operated her own beauty parlor, and every now and then she'd have another woman come in to help her, and she actually started this business when she was 16 in her basement. And there's nothing like working for yourself, and she had that mindset that she wanted to be in business for herself, and at that age, she started in the basement, and then by the time she got 18, she opened up the shop.
So that's what you like best about her, that she was...
Well, in other words, that told me a lot about this girl, who I didn't know very long. It told me that she had a good head on her shoulders, she was business-oriented, she wanted to work for herself, and she was aggressive enough to do it, and creative enough to do it. I mean, that includes all the bookkeeping, washing the floors, washing the windows, and taking care of customers, and doing the books. She did it all. So that said, boy, this girl make a real good wife. You know? So all of that went into my formula. And in addition, I was going to school, and I was getting low on my GI Bill. And not that that was a great factor, but after we got married, I guess we were married about a year or so, and I had to quit school because my money ran out. So she offered to...
You like best about her.
So she offered to, you know, let me go to school full-time and continue my studies and finish my degree, which is, I was 1 year away from it, in electrical engineering. And So she worked in her beauty shop and paid the rent and all the expenses, plus my school tuition, and it's the best investment she ever made. And so that's another aspect that came out in a short period of time.
All right, describe the day that you got married.
Chicago. It was cold and a little bit of snow on the ground, and we had a small wedding, and we went to the church, the Catholic church, and got married in the Catholic church. Made everything really legal, you know. And then went to her home for the reception, and we also had another reception the same day in one of the clubs, a dinner place, with some of my friends and some of her friends.
All right. Where did you go on your honeymoon?
Well, we didn't, because I had classes, and she had book schedules, so we took a rain check. Turns out like the rain check lasted a couple of years before we really had time, because I had to get through my degree, and you know how classes are. Mm-hmm. And she couldn't shut down her business, so we just took that in stride.
Okay, what's the best thing about having grandma being your wife?
Boy, that might take me all day to answer that question.
Try to sum it up.
Well, she's very flexible. She's intense and aggressive, just like she was when she was younger. She's still aggressive. I mean, aggressive in the set of responsibilities a woman has in a home, raising children, And that really paid off because she raised three boys, and that's the best prize that you can get. And she managed the house, she managed the money, and I would do most of the, you know, bring home the bacon. I forgot to mention that after 3 years of marriage, we had our first child, Jeff, and so she kind of closed down her business and sold the beauty shop so she could be a good mother. And then, of course, you know, she had a youngster, and I guess about 2 years later, her Larry came along, her Jeff's brother, and about 2.5 years later, Terry came along. So she was kind of busy with raising the family. She did that very well, and as the boys grew up, she got them into Cub Scouts and make sure that they were able to get along with people. They were raised as Catholics. They went to church every Sunday, and they went to the religious classes. And two of the boys, Larry and Terry, got to be altar boys. So she kind of rode herd on all of that. And in the meantime, I had graduated from college and got my degree, and was working in the missile field, the missile industry. And so we were both very preoccupied in raising the boys.
Okay. What was your favorite memory with Grandma?
Oh, gee, there's so many I can't really...
Well, the best, the very best.
Oh, I must be a thousand of them.
Can you pick one out?
As I said, we're dancers, and we were members of the little German band dance group. Mm-hmm. And this is a very aggressive style of dancing. Mm-hmm. And we practice once a week, just so when the band goes out on a job, that we could perform in public. And one of the good things about her, which I found out the first day I met her, that she was a good dancer, and she was consistent all those years in her dancing, and she learned to do a lot of Bavarian dancing, which occurs in Germany around Oktoberfest season. Mm-hmm. And we have costumes with dirndls, where you dress up, and I have lederhosen and all that sort of thing, and we all go out and perform in public. So she became an entertainer, as I did, mm-hmm. dance entertainment. And that got us back into a lot of the music that I had when I was younger, and I went back to my accordion playing. And I guess we've been with the little German band dance group for 17 years. So there's consistency there from the day I met her as a dancer, all of our married years, including 17 years of dancing with the little German band.
So your best memories were dancing with her?
Dancing, yeah.
And if there was anything you could change in your, like, in the past of your relationship, if there's anything you could change, what would it be? It could be nothing, but I'm saying it was, what would it be? Anything you might have done?
Well, if I could change it, I would have liked to finish my degree on my own and gone out and treated her into some international travel to show her that how much I loved her. What more can you think of? I mean, you got to tell your wife that you love her, and you got to do it not once a day, but several times a day. And I've been doing it for 52 years. 51.
All right, that's it.
Okay.
All right, thanks.
Thank you. Well, you got... what are you doing? You looking? Can I see? Oh, that's a good idea.
I know, you're a good kid to talk to. Okay.
All right, say your full name and your birth date.
My Lorraine Marie Pasango Petrovic. My birthday is February 20th, 1928.
Okay. When did you first hear about or see Grandpa?
Well, I ran into him at a dance. Mm-hmm. I was upset with my regular boyfriend who I was engaged to, And my sister Evelyn and I used to go dancing together. And we went to this ballroom, and this little fella came up to me and asked me if I'd like to dance. And I said, yes, I would. So we had a few dances, and then he asked if he could take me home. I said, well, my sister was with me too. So he said, well, I'll take her along too. So we were undecided we should really go, because my mother always said, be very careful when you go out.
Yeah.
So anyway, he did take us home, and he had a nice car, and he was very nice, very polite. And so then he asked for another date, and I said, well, you can call me. So he called me up. I think this was on, I'm not sure if it was Wednesday or Saturday that I first met him. But he did call me, and he asked me for another date, and I said yes. And then he said, well, thank you. He was very polite and very nice. So then we went out a few times, usually on a Wednesday and on the weekends. And then the first really weekend trip we went on was a picnic. Mm-hmm. So I had made chicken and all that sort of stuff. Mm-hmm. And when he came to pick me up, my mother took his license plate number. Because she wasn't sure about him because I didn't know.
My love, 264, my love, love's going to leave.
Bring me home safely. Then after that, we used to date mostly dancing, but then we used to go horseback riding a lot because I had my own horse at the time. So we did that a lot, and most of the time we just went out dancing. And I thought, gee, this is the fella I'd like to marry. And so I broke up with my other boyfriend, and I decided that I would marry my dear little Matt.
What was like, first thing you thought about him when he first asked you to dance that first night?
Well, I thought he was a very nice fellow. I mean, very polite and all, and I just felt very comfortable with him.
So what did you like most about Grandpa?
What I liked most about him, he was very thoughtful, very polite, very agreeable, and he is still to this day.
Where did Grandpa ask you to get married?
I think we sat and looked at his car, and he asked me. But first he had asked my mom and dad permission, and he did that. And after they said yes, well then I said yes.
So can you describe the day you got engaged?
Well, that was on Sweetest Day. That, I don't think they have Sweetest Day anymore. But that was in, in October, because we met in July. And so we got engaged in October, and then we were married in January. And then after 2 years later, we had our first son. And I got married in a suit because I was so practical. I said, well, at least I can wear my suit later on to different affairs rather than a gown. And so we had a reception at my mom's and dad's house. And just close.
Shining every day, clouds never get in.
you go on your honeymoon?
We didn't go anywhere because we couldn't afford it.
Okay, what was the best thing about having Grandpa as your husband?
The best thing, like I said, he's very thoughtful and he's very agreeable. He's got a very easy temper. He doesn't get upset too much. And when he does, he doesn't yell like me.
What is your favorite memory of Grandpa?
My favorite memory? Let me see. Well, I think the one time we went out, it was somebody's little summer home of some sort. And they said we could stay there for the weekend. And it was not my really favorite, but it was the most exciting because the accommodations weren't very the best. They were like straw mattresses or something, and we had to share one little bunk bed. But after that, we went out for dinner and all, and we were just happy to be there.
Change in the past of you and Grandpa's relationship, what would it be? Doesn't have to be anything, but if there was one thing you could think of.
I don't think there is anything, except I wish he was a little taller. Because my other boyfriend that I broke up with, he was, well, you don't remember what a Johnny Weissmuller was.
No.
He was a Tarzan.
Mm-hmm.
He was 6'2"
mm-hmm.
and real big. And then this little man came along into my life. And I decided to take him instead.
I wish you could see those.
see trees of green, red roses too. I see them bloom for me and you. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world. Skies of blue and clouds of white, the bright blessed day, the dark sacred night, and I think to myself, what a wonderful world. The colors of the rainbow, so pretty in the sky, are also on the faces of people going by. I see friends shaking hands, saying how do you do. They're really saying I love you. I hear babies cry, I watch them grow. Like much more than I ever knew, and I think to myself, what a wonderful world. Yes, I think to myself, what a wonderful world.
Down a river.
You don't know what
you've been cut. I thought you'd be in Canton.
No. I know you thought I was
there. Oh, goodness. What a surprise.
Yeah.
We goofed up. Matt was using on all the
while all this is going on, I'm going to go out and
okay, just stay seated for a while. The game plan is that we're going to play for about 15 or 20 minutes up here, and then we're going to tear down and set up in the back by the pool so you can dance there on the floor. And dancing is the name of the game here, and if you don't want to dance, have a little of that great beer that Larry got, and then you'll be dancing. And we want to thank everybody for showing up here. This is quite a surprise. Never thought this would happen. Anyway, we are the Party Time Button Box Band, and we want to know if you're ready to party.
Yeah!
Okay, we're going to give you a quiz. We're going to give you a quiz. Here we go with our theme song. Let's have a party.
With Matt and Lori tonight, we brought some music for your delight. So roll out the barrel and stand up and cheer. We're gonna play some music for everyone here. Welcome to the party and join with your friends, singing and dancing until the evening ends. We'll drink a toast till the barrel runs dry. We're gonna have a party for Matt and Lori tonight. To have a party for Matt and Lori tonight. We brought the music for your delight. So roll up the barrel, let's stand up and cheer. We're gonna play some music for everyone here. So welcome to their party and join with your friends, singing and dancing until the evening ends. We'll drink a toast till the barrel runs dry. We're gonna have a party for Matt and Lori tonight.
About, but there are several in the crowd who will know exactly what I mean.
Louder, louder.
Louder.
It sounds loud to me. We have had a family feud, a grudge match within this family. It's been secret to many. It's been a secret to many.
Not that secret.
But it's been happening for, as far as I can tell, 23 years. And I've been interested in this moment right now, right here, right now, for over 20 years, my own self.
Oh yeah, oh yeah.
The feud is between one Uncle Frank and his son-in-law Slavko. And it's all about the game of horseshoes. Horseshoes. For 23 years, we have been asking amongst ourselves, who's better? Uncle Frank? The veteran?
Slavko.
Or the man they call the lone assassin, Slavko. I got a fistful of money that says tonight, right now, right down there in the horseshoe pit, we're going to find out. Uncle Frank, Slavko, take your places.
No pressure.
The rules are the winner takes the fistful of money.
He's gonna get enough film.
Okay, we just want to say we love you either way. One of you will be a loser, but we don't care.
Hey, I didn't mean to be partial to Uncle Frank. You know, I was just trying to build him up.
You got a great son-in-law. Take him. Nobody's a loser.
No. You go on one side, and you go on the other. Yeah. Oh, look at him. Come on. No, you stay here for a second. Look at all the money.
So we're Terry and Terry beat us.
Well, I don't know.
But anyway, didn't you guys beat everybody today, you and Terry?
Were they a team, though?
No.
Terry, you better watch out.
They went together.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, they were testing.
But 23 years has some weight, too.
Yeah.
Terry's nothing wrong.
You call these pressure shots.
Where do I stand to get the pictures?
Oh! Oh! Oh, Slavko's putting a little pressure on right there. Whoa!
We got these filming.
Two.
Get the ref. Ref says two.
No, they probably
two to zero.
Two for Slavko.
That's more than I got all day.
Let's watch the arc on this shoe, ladies and gentlemen.
Put her in there, Slavko.
Okay. Yeah,
all right, the lone assassin.
Oh, he's joking.
Time, where's the announcer? Slavko, 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 Slavko.
Quiet,
quiet,
please.
Quiet, please. Quiet, please.
Quiet,
please.
Quiet, please.
Give the man! Give the man! be there, man, be there.
Pressure's on.
Yeah, pressure's on.
Still 2-0? Yep. 21. Best 2 out of 3, you know?
Okay, Ron, watch this.
I got you.
Too much pork.
Oh!
I'm just a poor wayfaring stranger, while traveling through this world of woe. There is no sickness, toil, or danger that bright world to which I go. I'm going there to see my father.
I'm going there no more to roam. I'm just a going over Jordan. I'm just a going over home. I'm just a poor wayfaring stranger. Now traveling through this world of woe. There is no sickness, joy, or danger.
Everybody for inviting us back this year. We love coming down to North Carolina to play this show. Some of you might remember, we had an old band called the Orlando Sidemen. You might recall that I was Orlando Sideman number 3. This year we're called the Wayfaring Stranger. Well, we're on congas, we got Matthew. Woo-hoo! Right here on lead guitar we got Uncle Ron. The bass man today is Uncle Tom. On vocals, we got Leslie. And on various instruments, Croatian and American, we got Uncle Mike. And over on maracas, we have Dysfunctional Child Z. And me, I'm just a poor wayfaring stranger, traveling through this world of woe. There is no sickness, toil, or danger in that bright world to which I go. Thank you.
tattoos for his friends. We'd sit around and get real stoned. And he fought with guys twice his size, so he wouldn't feel so alone. Angel said it was a shame. Angel, they loved him just the same. Angel, he said you had a mean streak in your heart. He had the Virgin on his back, and the one that said, I love you. And he never learned to read or write. I guess he figured, hey, what's the use? Angel said it was a shame. Angel, they loved him just the same. Angel, he said you had a mean streak in your heart. Mike, play one for Angel.
That hole for you.
How could I apply to you?
some morning. Background vocal talents of the rooster and his four hens.
Chicken.
July 27th, 1963, I was serving time for armed robbery. 3 o'clock in the morning, I was sitting in my cell. Heard a whistle blow.
There's a riot going on!
There's a riot going on. There's a riot going on. Cell block number 9. The warden came out and said, hey, put your hands up in the air. If you don't stop this riot, you're all about to get the chair. It was Uncle Matt. He said, it's too late, sir, to quit.
There's a riot going on.
He said, pass that dynamite, cause that fuse is lit. And there's a riot going on. Cell block number 9. Seventh hour, tear gas got our men. We're all in our cells, but every now and then there's a riot going on. 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 Up the cell block number 9.
Shorts a little tighter. Come on down, Larry.
All right, let's get
it. Larry's currently playing at Joe's Bar and Grill in Eustis on Sunday nights between 12 and 12:30. Okay, we're gonna vamp on G here. Ready? 1, 2, 3, 4.
Wishing I was on the lucky top down in the
and you see he'll
stand up.
Ain't no small, no more rocky job, ain't no telephone bill.
Come on, pick it up and down.
Ain't come up on a no rocky job, dirt to rocky by far. That's why all the folks on rocky job get their corn from the jar.
Turn you on? Huh? You getting excited, Joe?
We have this. I guess it's a mandolin. What is that, Tom? Yeah, whatever. We got the bongos. We got everybody up here going to play.
Uncle Matt, we need you. Washboard. Music played around here, and Lord don't lie, no music played around here. But we don't care what that Lord don't lie. We're gonna play some music anyhow. Lord, she don't want no music played around here. And Lord don't want no bongos played around here. She don't want no bongos played around here. But no Matthew, he don't care. He gonna play those bongos anyhow. Matthew's gonna play those bongos right about now. She don't play no tambourines. She don't allow no tambourines to play around here. She don't allow no tambourines to play around here. But we don't care what Lori don't allow. We're gonna listen to some tambourines right now. She don't want no tambourines to play around here. Tony right there. Tony does not care. And Lord, don't want no maracas played around here. She ain't having any maracas played around here. Steve don't care what that Lord or how he gonna bang that maraca anyhow. Listen to him. Just listen to him do it right here. She could not stand hearing an acoustic guitar around here. But Ronnie D, he don't care what you don't allow. He gonna play that acoustic guitar right now. Listen to Ronnie D playing it here. Bass guitar around here. She don't want to hear that bass guitar around here. DJ, he don't care what she don't allow. He's gonna play that bass guitar right now. Listen to him. He's playing it right cheap. Hates words tonight. I'll save it for last. And Lord don't like electric guitar around here. Cannot stand to hear electric guitar around here. But my mother, my brother, Mike, he don't care what you don't allow. Pick it on that guitar right now. Listen to him. To her for 50 years. He ain't gonna stop now. Do it, man. Right now. Disturbing part of the song because I heard when we pulled up yesterday that Aunt Lori does not want any celebrating around here, and I look out in the crowd and I see lots and lots of people, and I want to call some people up right now, right into the front here. We got people who, check this out, we got people, how far is it from Michigan to here in mileage?
744 miles.
750 miles. We got people who traveled 750 miles to be here right now. I want those people, the people who traveled 750 miles to come up right in the front here. Everyone who traveled 750, I want you to come up. These are the people who traveled 750 miles to be here. I just found out, Doris just told me, we got a couple of people from New York City, from NYC. I don't know, that's far. How far is that?
Real far!
It's real far. I want those two people to come on up, the people from New York City. We got a bunch of people I know, because I'm one of them, a bunch of people who came from Florida. They came all the way here from Florida. Huh? Well, they're not supposed to be up there. There's more. Trust me, there's more. That's like 600 miles. There's some of them are coming up. Now these are, you know, I was thinking about how Aunt Lori does not like any celebrating around here. All right? Okay, we got people who traveled across the yard. All right? But they did have to do some traveling. I want those people to come. Everybody who had to travel to get here, I want you to come up. And now I want Aunt Lori to come up here. I don't want you to come up, no, here. That's what I mean, here. Here means here. Now, Aunt Lori, you're my godmother. And I love you. That's the good news. And now here's the bad news. Take a look at all of those people who traveled all those many, many miles to be here. Well, Aunt Lori, we got some bad news for you today. All of us together. We don't care what you don't allow. We're going to celebrate anyhow. Let's do some celebrating right around here. We'll be right back.
freighter.